Where are the lost tribes of Israel today? The lost tribes of Israel are not in Israel today. Those in Israel are Jewish people who practice Judaism, which is a religion, not a bloodline. They are not the children of Jacob, which are the 12 tribes of Israel. They have claimed the heritage of a people that is not their own. They have no claims to the promises made to the biblical Israelites. There will be no peace in the land of Israel until the Messiah, Yahshua, returns and reigns with the true Israelites. As long as the land of Israel is trodden down by Gentiles, which are the so-called Jews, along with the Palestinians, and compassed about with armies, there will be no real peace. There is a clear distinction in Jews and Israelites. It must be understood that the term Jew is a modern term for a modern people, and in no way should be taken to represent the ancient people of the Bible. Publishers today will usually use the term Jew where it should state Israelites, and this is done deceptively to connect these modern people to an ancient heritage that is not their own. In order to find out where the lost tribes of Israel are today, we need to first return to the past. According to history, in the year 65 BC, the Roman armies under General Pompey captured Jerusalem. For over 100 years, the Israelites continued dwelling and practicing their customs while under the rule of the Roman Empire. By the time the Messiah had begun to preach, the Israelites had become weary of their Roman leaders. Even Herod, the Edomite king of Jerusalem, had to answer to Pontius Pilate, who was a Roman governor under the emperor of Tiberius. After the resurrection, just before the Messiah ascended to heaven, the apostles had a very important question to ask him.
When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power.
The apostles were concerned about the fact that Jerusalem was still under Gentile rulership, and since the Messiah had declared that all power was given unto him, they wanted to know if it was time for them to take the kingdom. Restore in Greek means to reconstitute, which means to re-establish Jerusalem to the glorified position as if it were under the rule of King David.
At the time of Yahshua the Messiah, the land of Israel was a part of the Roman Empire. South of Israel was Idumea and Edom. The king of Jerusalem was a Hebrew Edomite by the name of Herod. You know him as Herod the Great. He was responsible for murdering thousands of Hebrew Israelite babies during the birth of Yahshua. The land was full of Israelites that remembered the horror that this Edomite king had done in killing their kids. They longed to get revenge for their massacred babies. They wanted the Messiah to come back and kill this Edomite king. And they also wanted the Messiah to destroy the Roman Empire that ruled over them. Herod knew this. Herod knew that the Messiah, when he came, would overthrow his rulership. And this is why he killed all the firstborn.
These great beasts, which are four kings which shall arise out of the earth. But the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever.
The apostles were no doubt familiar with the scriptures in Daniel where it talked about the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever and ever. Listen to what Yahshua told his disciples.
And he said unto them, When I sent you without a purse and scrip and shoes, lacked ye anything? And they said, nothing. Then said he unto them, but now he that hath a purse, let him take it, and likewise his scrip. And he that hath no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. For I say unto you, that this that is written must yet be accomplished in me. And he was reckoned among the transgressors, for the things concerning me have an end. And they said, Lord, behold, here are two swords. And he said unto them, it is enough.
Wait a minute. Yeshua told Peter that it's time to get a sword? Let's bring that in today's time. A sword is a weapon for battle. In today's time, it would be a gun. So that was like Yeshua telling Peter, go get a couple of guns. We just might need them. This is why the disciples were expecting the restoration or the reestablishing of Israel. They were ready to come and overthrow the Roman Empire. Get this Edomite king out of his rule. But guess what? Another 70 years would go by. And not only did they have to suffer worse, but they had to be killed and even subject to slavery.
In 1969, a historian and major of Hebrew Aramaic studies, Dr. Rudolph R. Windsor, wrote a book titled From Babylon to Timbuktu. In his book, Dr. Windsor gives an account of the scattering of the Israelites. In 70 AD, General Vespasian and his son Titus put an end to the Jewish state with great slaughter. During the period of the military governors of Palestine, many outrageous and horrific atrocities were committed against the residue of the people. During the period of Pompey to Julius, it had been estimated that over 1 million Israelites fled into Africa, fleeing from Roman persecution and slavery. Millions of Israelites who escaped the persecution of the Roman-Jewish War fled into the interiors of Africa. You've got to ask yourself, why did the Israelites run to Africa? The same reason why the parents of the Messiah fled to Egypt, to blend in. They were black and needed to blend in with other dark-skinned people. Rudolph R. Windsor, in his book Babylon to Timbuktu, points out, the black Jews who migrated to the Sudan from the north converged with the black Jews migrating from the eastern Sudan to the countries of the Niger River. There is much proof, and still much more to be revealed by scholars, that there existed prior to the slave trade and subsequent to it many tribes, colonies, and kingdoms in West Africa. Page 120. 1600 years later, their descendants were rounded up and captured by African and the Arabs slave traders and sold to the Europeans, fulfilling the curses that were written in Deuteronomy, the 28th chapter. Moses forewarned the children of Israel of the curses that would befall them if they did not follow the commandments of the Most High.
But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. And the Lord shall scatter thee among all people, from the one end of the earth even unto the other. And there thou shalt serve other gods which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. And among these nations shalt thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest. But the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart, and failing of eyes, and sorrow of mind. And thy life shall hang in doubt before thee, and thou shalt fear day and night, and shalt have none assurance of thy life. In the morning thou shalt say, would God it were even! And at even thou shalt say, would God it were morning! For the fear of thine heart wherewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes which thou shalt see.
the particular curses that would befall the children of Israel for not keeping the commandments of the Most High is that they would suffer slavery similar to the type of slavery they suffered in Egypt, and that they would be transported into this new slavery on ships, and that the places where they would be transported, they'd be sold as slaves to their enemies. In Deuteronomy 28:68, it says this,
"And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, by the way whereof I spake unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again. And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you."
This is one of the links between the true Israelites of the Bible and the transatlantic slave trade. It explains how the Israelites fled into the interiors of Africa as refugees after the destruction of Jerusalem by the Romans in 70 AD. More than 1,500 years later, they were rounded up on the African continent and shipped all over the Western Hemisphere to be sold as slaves. This is the history that has been omitted from the pages of the European history.
You know, the scripture clearly states in several places where the children of Israel would be in the world. They're all over the world. They were sold as slaves to many nations. And you know, it also says that in the last days that they would still be in the land of their captivity and in the land of their enemies. And it also goes on to talk about what their lives would be like in the land of their enemies.
Baruch chapter 4, verse 6 and 15. "Ye were sold to the nations, not for your destruction, but because you moved God to wrath, you were delivered unto the enemies. For he hath brought a nation upon them from far, a shameless nation, and of a strange language, who neither reverenced old man nor pitied child."
This was obviously a future prophecy against the children of Israel, because at the time that this was written, the transatlantic slave trade had not happened yet. And so all of these nations that they were sold to would have been considered far and having a strange language. You know, the scripture talks about how this treacherous, ruthless nation that we were going to be sold to wouldn't have any regards for the old or the young. A lot of you may not know this, but our children were used as gator bait. You may have heard that term before. Gator bait is referencing how the slave master would take our children, tie ropes around them, and use their bodies to catch alligators. Now that is some evil stuff right there.
Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
Over the years, I've been collecting artifacts. As a matter of fact, I've been collecting little pencils like this. I've seen alligators on jars. I've seen alligator ashtrays, and I've seen them depicted with kids in it. And I was wondering why the children would be there. As a matter of fact, this particular pencil sharpener, this is a pencil sharpener or a pencil holder with a kid, a black head of a baby sitting out of its mouth. I didn't pay any attention. I have been collecting for quite a few years, and I have the posters and things like that about different things. And then one day I was down in Florida. I'd gone down with my wife and I took a trip for myself off to the Wild Blue Yonder, going out to hunt artifacts. And in my quest to hunt artifacts, I came upon a pawn shop in Sanford, Florida. In the pawn shop was a gentleman who owned it. They went and got him and told him I was there and I wanted to buy some of the shackles he had hanging around the walls. I asked him, could I buy them? He said no. He didn't want to sell anything. He just wanted me to see it. Then we began to talk. And I asked him, I said, "Look, please let me buy something. I got to take something from here." He says, "No." He says, "I don't want to sell anything." He said, "But I'm going to the back and I'll sit down." Meanwhile, he came out and came back out and began to talk to me. He said, "You know," he said, "you probably don't know this." He said, "but years ago," he said, my grandfather before he died told me of the things they would do. He said he would go down, he said his grandfather said they would go down and they would take babies with them. I said, what do you mean babies? He says, well, let me tell you. He said the slave babies, the slaves who had babies, they would steal the babies during the course of the day, sometimes when the mothers weren't washing. I said, what do you mean babies? I said, you mean babies like 5 or 6 years old? He says, no. These babies, some would be infants, some would be a year old. He said, some would be toddlers. He said, they would grab these children and take them down to the swamp and leave them in pens like little chicken coops. They would go down there at night, take these babies and tie them up because they hunted the big bull alligators. These big bull alligators were not raised on farms. They were in the wild. These alligators would weigh 600, 700, 800 pounds. Those are the ones they wanted. They would skin them, make the wallets, get the meat, do different things with them. He said, but what they were doing was tie them up, put a rope around their neck and around their torso, around here, and tie it tight. He said, the baby, I said, well, what would the babies be doing? He said, well, my grandfather said they'd be screaming. He said, what would you do? He said, just let them scream. He said, what they would do, it would help them to chum the water. He said, when they would throw the babies in tied to this rope, he said, in a matter of minutes, he said, the alligators were on them. He said, the alligators would clamp his jaws on that child. As a matter of fact, once he clamped on them, he was really swallowed. You couldn't see anything but the rope. And we would pull the alligator in and tie his nose and hit him in the head with an axe, a pickaxe. He said, we would then drag him to the shore. We'd drag him to the shore and leave him lay, and we would do it again, maybe 2 or 3 times a night. He said, I said, so what do you mean? He said, well, yeah, they were taking these babies and killing them for alligator bait. I said, so all these things I've been collecting, all these things I've been collecting are really, really something that I can really talk about and say they're of a truth. By what you say, he said, I'm telling you, he said, nobody wants to talk about it. He said, I'm only telling you because you're here. I may never hear from you again. He said, but these things actually depict the acts that they did to slave babies back in the Bayou country and down the South. They did this. They hunted alligators with these babies. That's why they call it alligator bait.
Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar tree.
You know, during slavery, oftentimes the children were separated from their parents. Our young girls would be sold to these oversexed men who would use their little bodies as sperm dumps. And they would be forced to give birth to a compromised offspring.
Thou shalt betroth a wife, and another man shall lie with her. Thou shalt build an house, and thou shalt not dwell therein.
One of the most shameful things that happened to us during slavery was when the slave master would come and take a wife from her husband and rape her. And prior to doing that, he would tell this man, boy, she better act like she like it. And if she just lay there as if she don't like it, I'm going to beat the hell out of you and her. Now that is a shameless person right there. A shameless person.
Because we were disobedient to the laws of the Most High, we fell by the sword and was delivered into the hands of our enemies. Who was Jacob's enemy? Who was Israel's enemy?
And I will set my face against you, and ye shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you, and ye shall flee when none pursueth you. Son of man, set thy face against Mount Seir, and prophesy against it, and say unto it, Thus saith the Lord God, Behold, O Mount Seir, I am against thee, and I will stretch out mine hand against thee, and I will make thee most desolate. I will lay thy cities waste, and thou shalt be desolate, and thou shalt know that I am the Lord. Because thou hast had a perpetual hatred, and hast shed the blood of the children of Israel by the force of the sword, in the time of their calamity, in the time that their iniquity had an end.
Israelites' enemy in the past has been Esau, Edom, since the time Esau sold his birthright. Who then is Mount Seir?
Edom.
Esau's hatred against the true Israelites has been so great until God has pronounced judgment upon him. Read it for yourself in the scriptures. He has pronounced judgment upon Edom. And to this day, the Edomites have a hate for the true descendants of Jacob.
Psalm 83, a song or psalm of Asaph. Keep not thou silence, O God. Hold not thy peace, and be not still, O God. For lo, thine enemies make a tumult, and they that hate thee have lifted up the head. They have taken crafty counsel against thy people, and consulted against thy hidden ones. They have said, Come, and let us cut them off from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance. For they have consulted together with one consent, they are confederate against thee, the tabernacles of Edom, and the Ishmaelites, of Moab, and the Hagarenes, Gebel and Ammon, and Amalek, the Philistines, with the inhabitants of Tyre. Asher also is joined with them. They have holpen the children of Lot, Selah.
According to this passage, Israel's enemy in the last days would come together and cut them off from being a people. And they would no longer remember that their forefather was Israel. This does not fit the description of the Jews today. But the Negro that was sold by the way of slave ships all over the world was completely robbed of his heritage. They were not allowed to remember their names, to keep their names, to remember their language, or to hold anything to their past. They are the true descendants of Israel, but they no longer remember that they are. Who are the nations that took crafty counsel against them? Look at the scripture. Who are the nations? Look at the names of these nations. It names Edom, which is Rome, the Europeans, Ishmaelites, Arab nations, Gebal, a region of Edom, Rome again, Amalek, a descendant of Esau, which is also Edom and Rome. The Philistines was a region of Syria, and the Hagarite was a member of certain Arabian clans. So basically, it's the Edomites of Rome and the Arabs of the Middle East. This is a clear prophecy about the Arab slave trade and the transatlantic slave trade.
The ox knoweth his owner, and the ass his master's crib, but Israel doth not know, my people doth not consider.
According to this scripture, Israel would not know their master, nor his master's crib. This has reference to do with them not knowing who they are or who their father is. The crib in Hebrew means a manger or a stall. In the case of the Hebrew Israelites, it's Israel. The so-called Jews, this isn't the case for them. They believe that they the Jews. It's us that don't believe that we are the true people, the true Hebrews of the Bible. It's us that do not know our father's real name. They are clueless and have completely lost their heritage.
And thou even thyself shalt discontinue from thine heritage that I gave thee, and I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in the land which thou knowest not. For ye have kindled a fire in mine anger, which shall burn forever.
Think about it. As soon as the slaves were sold, the masters changed their names, stopped them from speaking their native language, forbade them from learning how to read. This was all done to totally strip them of their heritage. Isn't this the same thing that happened to the Israelites in the scriptures? In the book of Daniel, the children of Israel was taken into captivity or slavery in Babylon under the rule of Nebuchadnezzar. The children known as Daniel, Hananiah, Michael, and Azariah. Names were all changed to what? Belshazzar, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That wasn't their real names. They changed their names. Why did they change their names? Because their names praised the Most High. Their names gave praise to the Most High. And they said, no, you are slaves. You ain't gonna be praising your God in our land if you're our slaves. You gonna praise our gods. That's what Daniel was thrown into the lion's den. That's why the three Hebrew boys were thrown into the fiery furnace. Because they didn't want to worship the other gods. They were the tribe of Judah. The same tribe that the scripture states would be in the land of captivity just before the battle of Armageddon.
For behold, in those days and in that time, when I shall bring again the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem, I will also gather all nations and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat, and will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land.
It has been estimated that more than 100 million Africans were taken as slaves during the transatlantic slave trade. These so-called Jews had a huge role in the transatlantic slave trade. When Columbus sailed to the Americas, he was accompanied by 5 Muranos, modern Jews. Gabriel Sanchez, abetted by the other 4 Jews, sold Columbus on the idea of slavery. Once the early so-called Jews settled in America, they set up the Jewish Newport World Center of Slave Commerce. The slave industry took off. The so-called Jews owned the slave ships that shipped the Negro across the world. They even manned the ships. When the so-called Jews sailed to Africa, they discovered true Israelite Hebrews living in very large communities in Nigeria, Ghana, and other West African nations. What better way to steal a people's identity than to exploit them and sell them into captivity? Slavery.
In a way, Lieutenant, they are the ultimate victims of recent history. If you'll favor my comparison, they are the wandering Jews of Africa. Fleeing the Pharaoh Shaka, they are the wandering Jews of Africa. Fleeing the Pharaoh Shaka, they are the wandering Jews of Africa. Fleeing the Pharaoh Shaka into the Babylonian captivity of slavery.
To this day, several tribes still consider themselves descendant from the true Israelites of the Bible, including the Igbo of Nigeria, Tutsis of East Africa, the Bamalikis of Cameroon, African tribes in Ghana, Mali, Uganda, South Africa, and the Lemba tribe of Zimbabwe.
The Lemba tribe, very possibly one of the lost scattered tribes of Israel, are located in remote communities in the heart of Zimbabwe. It is estimated that there may be as many as 400,000 of these ancient descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Oral tradition claims that their ancestors fled the Holy Land over 2,500 years ago. We know from recent DNA testing that many are Kohanim, or descendants of Aaron, the priest, the brother of Moses. They observe many biblical Jewish customs, like the dietary laws, the blowing of shofars, and circumcision. Today, they live in abject poverty. Most have never even seen a doctor or dentist.
From deep inside Africa, a sound is emanating that is causing reverberations around the world. A sound of a people casting off 2 centuries of colonialism, returning to what they say are their native roots.
I know from birth I'm a Jew. Only I know that my forefather missed the way.
I grew up alongside every other Igbo youth. We kept on hearing that Igbo people came from Israel.
There was a story my mom told me at the age of 6 years. I never forget. He said, the Igbos are Jews.
And it's a story of one man, Shmuel, who went searching for what that meant and found answers on the internet, prompting a journey that led him to a community of thousands of Jews. A place where resources are few, but commitment transcends. Through prayer, practice, ritual, diet, and song. But this is also the sound of doubt from Jews in America.
They would ask me, are you from America? I said, no, I'm a Nigerian. They say, you black? I said, yes. They said, no, it's not true.
And rejection from family and friends.
I am like an outcast among them.
And in this volatile Christian Muslim nation, doubt often turns to violence. This is the story of the Igbo, 25 million strong, a people once under siege by their very own government.
Biafra declared its independence.
And a people once captured and shipped across the Atlantic by the hundreds of thousands. A people who helped build America, and a people whose descendants are now discovering their Igbo roots, raising questions of cultural identity for countless African Americans.
Many African Americans actually do not know that they have Igbo heritage, the chances of them.
And just thinking about the hundreds of people, the thousands of people really, whose lives are going to be changed because of these Jewish people embracing Yeshua, coming to Yeshua as their Messiah, and being built up, being educated, being restored.
The tribe of Judah are the black Negroes that are shipped to North and South America, Haiti, Cuba, Mexico, Jamaica, Portugal, Spain, West Indies, and England. Even though the indigenous people of some of these areas were black, they were conquered by Europeans, and because of the mixing and mingling of the seed between European males and the black indigenous women, what you see today is essentially the creation of a third race.
When we were children, we were told that we have a motherland, and that motherland was Spain. However, we have discovered later in our lives that, as a matter of fact, we have several motherlands, and one of the greatest motherlands of all is no doubt Africa. We love Africa, and every day we are much more aware of the roots we have in Africa. Also, America is our motherland. Africa, America, and Bolivar used to say that we are a new human race in Latin America, that we are not Europeans, nor Africans, or North Americans, that we are a mixture of all those races, and there is no doubt that Africa resounds with a pulse like a thousand drums.
Many of the descendants of the Negroes shipped in slavery to these places are still there, and they are still black. However, the images widely shown of Portuguese, Argentine people, Uruguayans, Mexicans, Cubans, Guatemalans, Panamanians, North American Indians, and Puerto Ricans are a mixed race people, and many confuse them with the indigenous by claiming them to be as such and ignoring those of dark skin. The indigenous seed has been whited out and replaced with a lighter skinned mixed seed carbon copies of European father and a black indigenous mother. The other 11 tribes are still in Africa. Prophecy says that when the Messiah returns at the time of the Most High's wrath, He's going to gather his people, the other tribes, from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, but Judah from the four corners of the earth.
Therefore wait ye upon me, saith the Lord, until the day that I rise up to the prey, for my determination is to gather the nations, that I may assemble the kingdoms to pour upon them mine indignation, even all my fierce anger. For all the earth shall be devoured with the fire of my jealousy. For then will I turn to the people a pure language, that they may all call upon the name of the Lord, to serve him with one consent. From beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, my suppliants, even the daughter of my dispersed, shall bring mine offering. In that day shalt thou not be ashamed for all thy doings wherein thou hast transgressed against me. For then I will take away out of the midst of thee them that rejoice in thy pride, and thou shalt no more be haughty because of my holy mountain. I will also leave in the midst of thee an afflicted and poor people, and they shall trust in the name of the Lord. The remnant of Israel shall not do iniquity nor speak lies, neither shall a deceitful tongue be found in their mouth. For they shall feed and lie down, and none shall make them afraid. And in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, which shall stand for an ensign of the people. To it shall the Gentiles seek, and his rest shall be glorious. And it shall come to pass in that day, that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time, to recover the remnant of his people, which shall be left from Assyria, and from Egypt, and from Pathros, and from Cush, and from Elam, and from Shinar, and from Hamath, and from the islands of the sea. And he shall set up an ensign for the nations, and shall assemble the outcasts of Israel, and gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. The envy also of Ephraim shall depart, and the adversaries of Judah shall be cut off. Ephraim shall not envy Judah, and Judah shall not vex Ephraim. But they shall fly upon the shoulders of the Philistines toward the west, they shall spoil them of the east together, they shall lay their hand upon Edom and Moab, and the children of Ammon shall obey them.
He's going to gather his people, the other tribes, from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, but Judah from the four corners of the earth. Here is Ethiopia, and as you can see, beyond the rivers of Ethiopia would be in the direction of all the places where the Negro was captured. Beyond the rivers of Ethiopia is where they are. Ethiopia is Cush, the land of Cush. If you check the Hebrew word for Ethiopia, it's Cush. And if you look at the ancient map of Cush, it covers modern Sudan and Egypt. Look at the rivers of Cush. It's the Nile River that flows all the way from Egypt to modern Ethiopia. What's beyond the rivers of Cush? The inner parts of Africa, Ghana, Nigeria, Mali, Cameroon, Rwanda, Burundi, Uganda, Zimbabwe, and South Africa. If there are any true Israelites in China, Mexico, South America, Haiti, or India, they are Negroes. The tribe of Gad is South Africa. Listen to the prophecy in Genesis. Gad, a troop shall overcome him, but he shall overcome at the last. Genesis 49, verse 19. This is exactly what happened to the Zulu people of South Africa in 1879, an Anglo-Zulu war between the British Empire and the Zulu Kingdom. The British defeated the Zulus after a string of battles in South Africa. The Zulu Kingdom has been subjugated and the British leaders for over 100 years until Nelson Mandela became the president of South Africa in 1994. This set off a chain of events that caused the descendants of the Zulus to completely gain total control of their country. They are now taking back farms, lands, businesses, and whole corporations that are owned by whites. They have overcome the troop in these last days. No other black Negro nation on the planet has this testimony. The script also states, and I quote, "And of Gad he said, Blessed be he that enlargeth Gad. He dwelleth as a lion, and teareth the arm with the crown of the head." End of quote. Deuteronomy 33, verse 20. Currently, the Zulus are the largest South African ethnic group with an estimated 10 to 11 million people. During Shaka Zulu's time, the Zulu nation grew rapidly to 2 million square miles, consisting of 250,000 citizens and 40,000 soldiers. Notice the crown of the Zulu's head, a huge crown made of feathers. Look closely and you will see some very sharp, huge horns which would, and I quote, "teareth the arm with the crown of the head," end of quote, just like the scripture says.
The American blacks are descendants of the tribe of Judah. Joel 3:6 offers a significant insight. The children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have ye sold unto the Grecians, that ye might remove them far from their border. Leviticus 26:38, "And ye shall perish among the heathen, and the land of your enemies shall eat you up."
Baruch chapter 2, verse 29 through 35. "If ye will not hear my voice, surely this great multitude shall be turned into a small number among the nations where I will scatter them. For I knew that they would not hear me, because it is a stiff-necked people. But in the land of their captivities they shall remember themselves, and shall know that I am the Lord their God. For I will give them an heart and ears to hear, and they shall praise me in the land of their captivity, and think upon my name, and return from their stiff neck, and from their wicked deeds. For they shall remember the way of their fathers, which sinned before the Lord. And I will bring them again into the land which I promised with an oath unto their fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And they shall be lords of it, and I will increase them, and they shall not be diminished. And I will make an everlasting covenant with them to be their God, and they shall be my people. And I will no more drive my people Israel out of the land that I have given them."
The so-called Jews today did not wake up in the land of their slavery. They were not slaves in all the lands that they dwelt in. Not in Poland, not in Germany, not in Russia, not in America, and not in Spain. Even before the time of Hitler, they were not subject to slavery. Who and what people are still in the land of their captivity or slavery to this day? What people have had their heritage, language, and identity stripped to nothing? When the Most High, through Yahshua, gathers his people, they will still be in the land of their captivity or in the land of their slavery. And only then will he set up the millennial and make a covenant with his people. And there will be what? Peace in the Middle East when he comes and set up things. But what do you see now? Now that the so-called Jews are over in the land of Israel in the Middle East, what do you see? You see war and havoc. As a matter of fact, Israelites, or shall I say, as a matter of fact, Jews are now leaving the land of Israel because they believe it is unsafe to live there.
Israel was created as the promised land to provide a home for all Jews of the world. But tens of thousands have fled the country over the past few years, and more are lining up to leave.
There's a passage in Psalms that only describes us, and the movie Roots captured it very well. The passage that says, "Sing us one of those songs of Zion." Now, in the movie Roots, the woman actually said, "Sing me one of those Negro spirituals."
I wonder if you would favor us with one of those magnificent Negro spirituals.
Nobody knows the trouble I've seen.
Psalm 137. "By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof, For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song, and they that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, Sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land?
Lord, nobody knows the trouble I've
You know, the slave master used to have us singing and dancing for them all the time. And guess what, y'all? We still singing and dancing for their descendants.
The slave master waxed rich through slavery, and their descendants inherited all the wealth. Europeans benefit greatly on a system built on slavery.
The mistake they've made, to deal with the racial part of this, is their boot has been on the necks of people of color since we began. This is a nation founded on genocide and built on the backs of slaves, all right? So we started with a racial problem. We tried to eliminate one entire race, and then we used another race to build this country actually quite quickly as a new country into a world power. This country never would have had the wealth that it had it not had slavery for a couple of hundred years. If it had to pay people, they actually had to pay people to build America. You know, we might just be at that point in Utah where we're joining the two rails together, maybe at this point right now.